Staying On by Paul Scott. Copyright 1977 by Paul Scott. Chapter 1. When Tusker Smalley died of a massive coronary at approximately 9:30 a.m. on the last Monday in April 1972, his wife Lucy was out, having her white hair blue-rinsed and set in the seraglio room on the ground floor of Pankot's new five-story glass and concrete hotel, the Shiraz. The Shiraz was only a step or two away from the little hill station's old hotel, Smith's, whose annex had been occupied by Tusker and Lucy for 10 years. The annex, known as the Lodge, was a small bungalow in what had once been an adjacent but separate compound, a second of whose dividing wall had been knocked down and a path trodden to create an illusion of connection between hotel and annex. The old gateway into the lodge's compound, now known as the side entrance, gave onto a lane. Immediately opposite was the Shiraz. If Tusker had been found at once, then, and a message sent across, Lucy would have had the news at just the moment any woman would subsequently have to think of as the most inconvenient at which to hear she had become a widow. At 9:30, she was going under the dryer. But Tusker lay dead for half an hour, and might have lain longer if Mrs. Bullaboy, who owned Smith's and lived in one of its principal rooms, hadn't become unnerved by the howling of Colonel and Mrs. Smalley's dog, Bloxor. The howling was not very loud, because the dog was locked in Colonel Smalley's garage, but it was persistent, so Mr. Bullaboy was ordered over to complain on Mrs. Bullaboy's behalf. Mrs. Bullaboy, who had jowls and favoured saris in pastel colours such as salmon pink, which emphasised the fairness of her skin, was a martyr to several things, among them migraine. On mornings when she kept to her room, work at Smith's Hotel came virtually to a standstill. The slightest percussive sound was more than she was prepared to bear. The hotel was hers, Mr. Bullaboy merely its manager, whom she had married. Mrs. Bullaboy weighed 16 stone. Her husband was constructed on more meagre lines. Mr. Bullaboy had managed Smith's for years before the woman he married turned up as its new proprietor. He was her third and youngest husband, according to Tusker Smalley, probably the lucky one, because she was unlikely to enjoy a fourth, being now almost as richly endowed with killing flesh as with life-enhancing rupees. Tusker, who called Mr. Bullaboy Billy Boy, except when they had quarrelled, which sometimes they had to, said Billy Boy looked like a man who, inured to disappointment, had suddenly glimpsed an immense possibility and begun to organise himself so as not to make the mistake that would block his way to it. Mrs. Bullaboy had had no children by any of her husbands. "He stands to gain," Tusker had often pointed out to Lucy, "and he feeds her up a treat. One day she'll drop." Actually, Mrs. Bullaboy fed herself without either Mr. Bullaboy's help or hindrance. His policy was to minimize every risk of incurring her displeasure. These risks were many. On her good days, when she waddled about looking into this and that and finding fault, he followed in her galleon wake, in his neat, well-pressed suit, making sure her orders were carried out and the sources of her irritation at once put a stop to. On her bad days, he walked on tiptoe and had the entire staff doing the same, so that even the guests, when there were any, felt themselves under a cloud and got out of the place as soon as possible after breakfast. The last Monday morning in this April, April the 24th, was such a morning, if anything heavier than usual with the pressure of Mrs. Bullaboy's martyrdom, which throbbed like a silent fog warning through the hotel from the shuttered bedroom, the old number one, where she lay on a massive double bed which she took up most of. Occasionally, Mr. Bullaboy was detailed to share this bed, but had not been the previous night when he had slept in his own room, the old number 2. The 2 rooms were en suite with a communicating door which Mr. Bullaboy never bolted his side of, but which frequently did not give to his gentle midnight nudge. He had not nudged it the night before. Sunday had been a shattering day. At 7:30 a.m. he was summoned from number 2 to number 1 by his wife's personal maid, a local Pankot woman whom they called by the name she had been given long ago by the British military family who employed her as a little ayah until they went home in 1947, Minnie. Minnie was now plump, middle-aged, and grumpy. Mr. Bullaboy got no change out of her. She took orders only from Mrs. Bullaboy, and not always from her. Mr. Bullaboy maintained a cautious attitude to Minnie. Sometimes Minnie complained about him to Mrs. Bullaboy, or about what she called management, which came to the same thing. This led to Mrs. Bullaboy shouting at him. At other times, when Minnie was being uncooperative, even with Mrs. Bullaboy, he got shouted at again. "You can't win, old man," Tusker had told him. "Not with women. Minnie probably fancies you. It gives her a kick to get you into trouble. Obviously, you've never made a pass at her. Try it."
"No, no. It must be menopause."
"In that case, she ought to go into the next Guinness Book of Records. You've been saying that for years. Have another peg." So they had had another peg. That was a week ago. Monday evenings were evenings Mr. Bullaboy usually looked forward to. However badly Monday started, however badly indisposed Mrs. Bullaboy was at breakfast time, by lunch she had usually recovered sufficiently to take some nourishment, and so fortify herself to spend the rest of the gruelling day playing bridge at the Pankot Gymkhana Club. Mondays were not her only bridge days. There could be sessions on Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, but never Sunday, because Sunday was Mr. Bullaboy's day off and her day for checking his records of the hotel's income and expenditure, which often contributed to the fact that there could easily be a difference of opinion between them on Sunday evening, a celibate night for Mr. Bullaboy and a Monday morning migraine for his wife. What gave Monday evenings their attraction was not just that Mrs. Bullaboy could be counted on to stay late at the club, but also that on these evenings Mrs. Smalley took herself to the pictures at the New Electric. Once Mr. Bullaboy had seen the last evening guest out of Smith's dining room and ensured that the servants were beginning to clear up and the kitchen staff to wash up, that cook had remembered to prepare Mrs. Bullaboy's midnight snack, that Minnie had properly arranged her mistress's bed and was somewhere within her mistress's immediate call, then he and Tusker could meet over a bottle either at the lodge or on the veranda of the hotel, where the sound of Mrs. Bullaboy returning could be better heard. Neither man got drunk. Tusker drank more than Mr. Bullaboy, but then Tusker was a member, the last surviving member in Pankot, with his wife, of the old school of British, and needed his liquor. Mr. Bullaboy drank less, not only because he had principles, frail at times, but because he loved listening to Tusker, who seemed to know so much about such a lot. Old scandal, new scandal, local scandal, international scandal. The Profumo affair, the Kennedy assassination, why President Johnson pulled dogs by their ears, why Prime Minister Heath was married to a boat, why it was that the British were pro-Pakistan in the first Indo-Pak War and pro-India in the one just finished, and what Henry Kissinger had said to the dumbest blonde in Connecticut who only wanted to send a message to her mama in Warsaw. Over the years of their convivial Mondays, Mr. Bullaboy had gathered a great deal of esoteric information about presidents, palaces, and people's democracies. The range of Tusker's knowledge of the world had astonished him, fascinated him. He often wished he could remember 1/10 of what he had learned, been told. and sometimes thought he might have done so if he had got as well oiled as Tusker. But apart from his principles, his preference for hearing clearly what Tusker was saying, his relative...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.